A year after the murder of George Floyd, many corporations and CEOs made very, very lofty and big promises about how they were going to change in the wake of this massive movement for racial justice and police reform. So how have those corporations done who were so keen to jump on that bandwagon? Not well, let's just put it like that. So as protests unfolded in the weeks following his death, corporate America spoke out against racism and police brutality. Promises were made to invest in fighting racial inequality, supporting minority-owned businesses, lobbying for police reforms that address misconduct and accountability, and to provide more opportunities to Black Americans within these companies. I believe we have a graphic that shows just how much the words George Floyd and systemic racism and Black Lives Matter were used in the boardroom. So lots and lots of a spike in that discussion. But according to the Financial Times, an assessment of the changes that have been made in the intervening period suggests that Floyd's death did catalyze corporate diversity, equity, and inclusion efforts. But on several key measures, more still needs to be done to change, to turn executives' newly activist rhetoric into reality. So let's look at those various areas, all right? Number one, it's the most concrete. Did they donate the money, spending? So American corporations have pledged to spend $50 billion on racial equity since Floyd's murder, according to a tally of public promises compiled by the Creative Investment Research. The funds were to be spread between donations to civil rights organizations, targeted investments in communities of color, and overhauls of the internal recruiting and training programs. Yet only about $250 million has actually been spent or committed to a specific initiative, according to an analysis by the research consulting firm. Let's just stop there. That is far short. That is $49,750,000,000 short of the pledge that was made. Now, I know some of these pledges are gonna be over time, but Dr. Richey, what are your thoughts on just that piece?
Well, we should have known they were playing games when they made these pledges and then did not make the internal policy change to connect executive bonuses to diversity goals. So right now, all of your major companies, if you're an executive at one of those companies, you get a bonus. You get a bonus for reaching particular goals. When these companies refuse to connect their diversity number goals to your executive bonus, we should have known they were playing a game. Number two, a lot of these pledges that took place, obviously took place at the height of the controversy. And they went out, promoted this pledge. They had to spend very little money. I would argue they actually got more in advertising than they had to actually spend in partial adherence to their promise. So they're still winning while Black folks are still losing. They did not get squarely behind the George Floyd Policing and Accountability Justice Act. They have not been actual advocates, as they said. And here's how you start really fixing the problem. Make sure you hire individuals of a particular background to be the executives and in charge of these corporations. We are a combination of three E's. I tell my college students this on a regular basis: experiences, exposure, and environment. That's who we are. We are a social design of our experiences, exposures, and environment. Me, as a Black man in America, I have a unique set of three E's. I bring a unique perspective to a boardroom. I have a unique understanding of what's happening socially in our community. Those are the people you have to hire. In a recent study, only 37% of actual companies, major companies, have some level of diversity inclusion training or trying to reach diversity goals in their corporate ranks. That's sad, that's a minority of the businesses, but all of the businesses said they were on board with moving this country forward and down with Black Lives Matter.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like even the progress that was made, the most progress was made in hiring. And yet that in and of itself, especially among like the Fortune 500 companies, is not enough. So just a little bit more on that. Fortune 1000 firms have made notable progress diversifying their C-suites and boardrooms. In December, Nasdaq CEO Adina Friedman proposed a new rule requiring companies listed on any Nasdaq-owned stock exchange in the US to disclose consistent, transparent diversity statistics regarding their board of directors. The proposal would require almost require most NASDAQ companies have, or to explain why they have not, at least two diverse directors, which may include one woman and one board member of an underrepresented minority group. But recent data shows that most of those diversity gains have gone to women and Latinos and not black leadership, black Americans, according to Mike Heider, the president and CEO of Executive Leadership Council, a national organization for current and former black CEOs and senior executives. So that right there is essentially that, you know, two diverse members, which is very nonspecific. It's not even clear how big the boards have to be, just two diverse members, underrepresented, and that most of them have gone to women. So again, when it's not explicitly laid out, like we would like, or we should have a certain number of black like board members, then it doesn't happen. If you just broadly characterize it as diverse, you're not gonna get black folks. So Adam, Dr. Rashad or Richey, what do you think?
Isn't it ironic that the entire genesis of this started with Black Lives Matter? Yeah. The individuals who are the public sacrificial lambs, like George Floyd, are black. And corporations say, we're down with BLM. So let's hire a white woman and somebody other than a black person to serve on the board of directors. As a matter of fact, let's make that the policy so that we don't have to say the word black in our hiring practice. Now let's go back to what a lot of politicians will say. Well, we can't make laws that simply cater to one group or one race. They'll say things like that. One race, you can't make a law to say that. But I remember laws were made to say exactly that, when city governments and county governments and state governments said white only, black's not allowed. Mm-hmm. That was the statutory language. We know it has been done. And if there's not an incentive, and once again, what we're seeing is systemic bias being played out even inside of the groups where we should be coalition. These biases are continuing to play out at the same rate where Black Lives Matter or organizations that are represented by black folks will bring it to the forefront of corporate America, and corporate America will respond by putting black folks at the end or the bottom of the totem pole when it comes to actual corporate action.
Yeah, and remember, this is not Fortune 500 or like the top two or three companies. It's a Fortune 1000. There's a lot of companies. And yeah, a lot of them might be, you know, financial companies, tech companies, etc. But look, I'm not someone who thinks that suddenly when you diversify a boardroom, the goal of like an investment firm becomes any more like actually benevolent than it really is, you know, or that of, you know, a pharmaceutical company is incredible. But I do think it matters. I do think it does change a culture. And I do think that it isn't nothing. Like, I mean, and this is sort of like, yes, we're all trying to get free from these general like systems like capitalism, exploitative capitalism.
Right.
But in the meantime, the incrementalism on that can mean, you know, diversifying boardrooms, and it does matter. And like Dr. Richey was saying, experience of the people in the room also still matters. I also am thinking about corporations like Amazon, who are like, we're gonna put our black stories up, you know, and like you can have our playlist where you watch all of the movies with, you know, Denzel Washington or whatever, you know, like,
right.
And it's just like, it's so pathetic and it's so mealy mouthed, and yet I am happy that it exists. And so I'm of two minds. The problem is, if these corporations, because you know Amazon actually committed money, I'm sure they did. I don't have the breakdown of exactly which corporations did or did not pledge money, but you only have $25 million of the $50 billion pledged by these corporations. Come on. You know, meanwhile, they've been making hand over fist money in this pandemic, right?
Yeah.
And hand over fist money, not to be too whatever, but like selling black culture, right? Back to the American public at large, benefiting from black culture, black labor at all levels of the corporate structure, from minimum wage to culture workers, you know, to professionals, to professors. And so put your money where your mouth is, and they haven't.
What you see happening is that corporations basically signed up for this agenda to give themselves protection. And some of them have been so crafty that not only did they give themselves protection, but they also were able to create earned media to the tune or higher than what they actually gave money to, right?
Yeah.
So yeah, a lot of them, I would dare to say most of them will not actually make good on their promise, because their promise was gratuitous. And a gratuitous promise is typically not enforceable in a court of law, and most of these nonprofits will not hold them accountable to that degree. And they will be able to say, hey, I pledge 100 million, they give 50,000, and then they say, oh, our funding priorities have changed since then. Well, in the meantime, they've received like $1 million in advertisement and articles and good public relations because they said they were going to give a whole lot of money.
Yeah. One final piece on this that I wanted to ask you about is pay equity. So it turns out that, and this is from the same Financial Times article, when Just Capital released a tracker of companies' commitments to racial equity earlier this month, only 31% of the country's 100 largest companies were analyzing how equitably they paid employees of different races and ethnicities. Only 31%. So that implicit bias is just allowed to fester. You're like, I don't know why. I mean, yeah, you're doing the same job and you're black and you make 50,000 less than your counterpart or 30,000 or whatever, which happens all the time. I think everyone has a story of being utterly shocked by a pay gap between whether it's people of color and white people, women and men. Like, you'd be surprised what corporations are getting away with.
Yeah, think about this. 31% of the companies are actually looking at it, right? So the vast majority of companies are saying, we're not going to look at it. Now, maybe you arrived at the problem by way of implicit bias or unconscious bias, but you remain in the problem by way of intentional bias, because you refused to evaluate your company on a social marker that should be part of the design of your corporation. So yeah, at some point, it's no longer implicit. Once it is brought to the forefront of your attention, it is now intentional.
For more political news breakdowns, interviews, stories of activism, and me trying my hardest to care about the occasional big celebrity news story, subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/thedamagereport. And you can ring the bell wherever it is so you don't miss anything.